Hello, I'm Anne McLean for Concerts from the Library of Congress. This week, we're delighted to be presenting the Distinguished French Period Orchestra Ensemble Correspondance. And I'm very pleased to be talking today with its conductor, Sébastien Dossé. Thank you for joining me.
Thank you very much for inviting me.
We're looking forward very much to sharing your beautiful program, Pleasures of the Louvre, with our audiences, recorded at the Louvre, actually. And I would like to acknowledge here the generous support of the cultural services of the French Embassy in the United States in making this webcast possible. Your website describes you as fired by the urge to revive both the sacred and secular music of the French 17th century. And I wondered, has this been a focus for you from the beginning of the ensemble? What sparked your passion for this music?
I don't really know where does it come from. I think the very first sounds I've heard in the radio, in the cinema, which really touched me, were music of this time. I don't know how to explain that, but the way of singing, the ornaments, the probably all the stories that are around this music, probably when I was a teenager, impressed me a lot. So from this moment, I think I've chosen to play this music and to enter in and to know more about the way of playing this music. So I think it started at this moment. Then after my studies in the conservatory in Lyon, where we learned about Bach music and German music, a little bit English music, but not so much French music. I felt very frustrated. So I decided to really to create the ensemble, probably just to stop this frustration with French repertoire. And it was, I think, the beginning of the research, the beginning of this moment. I wanted to discover new things, to know more than what I already knew.
You know, I was thinking too about this tour that you made and how you went to see all the beautiful churches and so on. And I was thinking about when I heard you at Ambronay, in the festival there. It was so charming to see the tremendous response from the people and a very warm feeling in the cathedral there. And I was thinking too, you now have become really established. Of course, you have a very impressive status as an ensemble, but the French government has been very supportive for you and so on. And now you're a Compagnie Nationale de France, I believe. And you know, you have a residency at Versailles and other institutions. And I was wondering if you'd wanted to comment just for a moment about how very important, how significant early music seems to be for French audiences. It's quite a following.
Yeah, I think it's the proof that politics can be very efficient. As you know, in France we have a special system for musicians, which is intermittent du spectacle. This is a special statute for the musicians, which helps when you don't have work. So, for instance, we are all protected by the government. Of course, it's not a big amount, but it's something that protects. And I think this general system helps the musicians, the programmers, the theaters, everyone in this ecosystem of music to take a risk. And I think we are now many musicians to have an interest for ancient music. And I think it is allowed by this general system. As if there was no protection at all, I think we probably would have studied in a different way. Probably not especially this repertoire, but we would have studied just maybe to become a violinist in a permanent orchestra, or just to be maybe just safe and have a job. Yeah. So I think this explains probably that it allowed the musicians to go to the repertoires they are interested in. Then you can see that the audience loved loves, really loves this music. So Ambronay is an example, but you have many festivals in France, specialized or not specialized, but with early music. And all these concerts have a great audience. So I think that, it's an effect, indirectly, it's an effect of the politics from maybe 40 years, and it joins the taste of the audience.
It really, the success is remarkable. You know, this is a great segue into the politics of this program that you're presenting, Pleasures of the Louvre. In terms of the multimedia dimension of this program in particular, tell us a little bit about the nature of the court entertainments at that time. This is the court of Louis XIII at the Louvre.
Yeah, we had many, many different things for divertissement at this time. And I think this program is quite interesting because if you just hear the music, all these pieces of music are called airs. But some of them are coming directly from the king's apartments, as Louis XIII loved music probably more than Louis XIV. And he was himself a musician, but also a composer. He composed a whole ballet de cour. And Louis XIII had a daily music with a team of around 15 musicians just to play music for him, depending on, of course, on his will. But he could ask for music at every moment of the day. And that was this little team, which is called La Chambre du Roi. And these musicians of La Chambre du Roi are singers, but also soft instruments like spinets, lutes, gambas, flutes. And the repertoire they play is mainly airs de cour, which were coming from the city of Paris, from the salon in the noble buildings, which are called hôtels particuliers, in which the noble woman could invite an assembly of 10, 15, 20, but rarely more, people to discuss about music, philosophy, literature, and all the subject of this time. And in this salon, they invented the idea of composing a poetry and then sing yourself this poetry with your lute. So this was the beginning of airs de cour, and this genre came to the Louvre, to the king's apartment. Then you could have this kind of music with royal composers as François de Chancy, Antoine Boesset, Pierre Guédron, which were the main composers of this time. And you had in another part the great shows for the all the courtiers, and many great shows were played in a beautiful hall which was called Le Petit Bourbon, which is now destroyed, but it is at the exact place of the colonnade du Louvre at the west part of the palace. And in this political hall, which this hall was made for politic meetings, but it was also used for the great shows of theater, of ballet de cour. And it was in this hall you could have until 4,000 people. So it was definitely no more the little salon with 10 people, but the big thing. But the music looks like the same. It's quite strange because the style of the music is the same and the singers are the same, which is quite interesting because how is it possible to have a very delicate singing when you sing for the king, who is at 2 meters from you, and then the same week sing for a giant place with 4,000 people and seeing the same air de cour. It is quite strange, but I think that, that there is a mystery under that. And yeah, so on the you ask about the multi-dimension shows with the staging, the settings, the costumes. That yeah, at this time we loved the genre of the ballet de cour, which was mainly danced and with instrumental music, but we had some air de cour inside. But probably it was not a ballet as we can imagine it today, because it was something more, maybe more social, as the courtiers themselves were dancing close to the king in this ballet de cour. So you were attending a show, but also participating in this show as a great honor, because you were invited to dance very close to the king. So it's it was a whole night. Usually it was starting at 6 p.m. and finishing at 3 in the night, and you had this ballet de cour, which was like a virtuosity of imagination. All the subjects, all the machines, the new machines coming from Italy were invited. The beautiful costumes, because as you were invited to dance, it was such an honor that you could spend a lot of money to have the most beautiful costume. It's a little bit like a voguing dance, you know, this kind of dance. And you have maybe 1 or 2 minutes to dance in this show, to perform a dance close to the king, and in these 2 minutes you have to show the maximum you can. So it was probably the most spectacular shows we had, even maybe more impressive than opera.
And these are these nobles were really, as you say, showing their support for the monarch by participating in this spectacle that was both public and private. It had dimensions of both worlds, and really a theater. I read this expression, theater of power, that it was a display too of the magnificence of the king and his courtiers and so on. And the costumes, I think I read that the king designed a few himself even, and he composed this. One of the pieces our audiences will hear, Les Gascons, is from, he created it himself. Do we have scores for those? How do you? I know you do tremendous research for each one of these programs. Did you? Is there an extant score?
Yeah, we have. Of course, we don't have as much music as we could have with opera, because opera was bound to be commercial. It had to find an audience, and Lully had to sell his scores. At this moment, ballet de cour are non-commercial art, as the king is paying everything, and you can spend millions of money, but you don't care if you play it just once. So this is quite different, and so the music was not published. This is the answer. The music was not published. The only thing which was published was the libretto, and as you know, for in a ballet de cour, for each dance, which is called an entrée, for each entrée, you have a poem, but also the list of the dancers and the list of the characters they are dancing. So it's like for each dance, which could last only 2 minutes, it's like a little program. So we have this booklet for many ballet de cour, and for the music, it's quite strange, because the research started at the end of the reign of Louis XIV, as his librarian Philidor, who was working as a composer but also as a librarian, started to interest himself about the ancient music, the early music of this time. So he started to research in the archives of the Louvre, then of Versailles, and tried to refine ancient music from the reign of Henry IV or Louis XIII. At this moment, he found some ballet music And he started to copy this music. Sometimes, for instance, for the Ballet de la Merlaison, which is the one composed by Louis XIII, he had all the music with all the parts of the orchestra. But for another ballet, which is very famous, which is the Ballet Royal de la Nuit, we have recorded a few years ago, in which Louis XIV danced as the sun, which is quite famous. For instance, this Ballet Royal de la Nuit has only the violin part. So you have to rewrite, to guess, to be yourself a composer of this time, to complete. So the music is sometimes very complete, but it's very rare, and sometimes just some parts. And the for the ballet cours, I think probably the 2/3 of the music is lost.
You know, let's talk about, you mentioned the violin. Let's talk about the instruments for a moment. The ensemble that you have that we'll hear on your performance, in your performance, it's 6 viols and bass lute, and recorder. Is this similar to what we would have heard at the court in those times?
Yeah, I think it's exactly the team, not for the ballet cours, which was probably more orchestral, but I think it's the quite exact theme of the king's music in the Chambre du Roi. So for the king's apartment, he has probably this team of musicians, between around 10 musicians, singers, and around 6-7 instrumentalists. So this is exactly, I think, the we are very close to the sound he could have in little spaces in the Louvre.
You know, I was reading this very strange concept of it, the word ruelle, R-U-E-L-L-E-S, and the definition is that is the space between the bed and the wall originally. But so again, back to this concept of a terribly private performance. Elaborate on that a moment.
I think this is very strange to understand nowadays, that a noble woman of this time could invite an assembly in her bedroom to play music. Today, it wouldn't mean the same thing. But I think at this time, the hotel particulier, the great building, the noble master and lady lived in the first floor, and they had a suite of apartments. And the most private, but not intimate, the most private was la chambre. Then just before, you had the antichambre, and the antichambre was for people you know, but not so well, and just to settle things with clients. But the chambre was reserved for very close people. So when you were at this time a noble woman, you could invite friends, close friends, in this room, which had a bed, but this bed was not to sleep. It was to show a beautiful furniture. So she could stand on the bed, but just as on a chair, and have all this assembly with a table, with chairs around, but every furniture except the bed was movable. I don't know if it,
yeah.
So this is an open space of this time, but quite confidential, and the people who could enter in this chambre were very selected.
Interesting. It gives you a different picture of the performance possibilities. And I know these musicians had to be incredibly talented and also nimble, because they moved from the Palace of the Louvre to other places with the court when it moved. So as I understand, they would have had to suddenly shift from a large ensemble performance of a specific work to smaller forces and the same work and so on. Just very, very gifted musicians. And I was thinking, too, about the nature of the music that we hear in this performance. It would be easy for people who don't know these backgrounds, which are so fascinating, to perceive the poems and the performances as being very innocent and, you know, charming and perhaps like the feeling of the pastoral, you know, and so on. But in fact, they were often very political. Is that not the case? They were pointed, satirical even, some of the pieces. Which pieces in your performance should we look out for in this way?
I think that the question of the text is very interesting because it can look very sometimes very naive, like all the pastoral things. But I think we have to be in the head of an artist of this time in the salon when you played an air with your lute. You are singing, for instance, the story of Tircis, the young shepherd who suffer from the cruelty of a shepherdess. But when you are singing that, you are looking everyone, you are thinking to things which are real. So it's like a mirror of a situation that really exists in this little society. So when you know that, it's really less naive. And for the political things, of course, the composers around the king, like Boisset, like Guédron, are, of course, obliged to sing the beauties of the reign of the king of the queen. So it's like an obliged exercise. But I think what is interesting, like for the airs, like for the ballets, is how these musicians agree with this obligation, but they are able to do something more interesting than just this révérence. So, for instance, Monarque Triomphant, this kind of air are directly addressed to the king and flattering the king. But I think in this kind of air, the music tells more than that.
You know, it's interesting to think about what you're saying in the context of the life of the queen and of Austria, because such a hotbed of intrigue and, you know, people suspected her of treasonous activities, and Richelieu was expecting that she might be removed or, you know, put into a confinement. But when you think about these people performing in front of a court who knew all the dimensions of these scandals and so on, it's rather remarkable. Are there any letters about such things or information that has come down about that?
No, but what we can say is it's very strange for us today to see this extreme refinement at the same moment with this extreme cruelty. All these people who were able to appreciate or to play or to sing the most beautiful things were also able to kill the minute after. So this is, yeah, I think the society evolves.
We hope. About the style of the music, can you expound a little on the style, the galant? Because for many people who are music lovers, they think of style galant with post-Bach, you know, post-Baroque, with the very simple style. What does the galant culture imply? What are its characteristics for this music?
I think this how you can translate this galanterie in music. I think for an air de cour, for instance, it's first a sort of simplicity. When you hear for the first time an air de cour, it's like an easy tune, beautiful, very soft, with a simple harmony, and it looks like something you can memorize very quickly. And the poetry at this time are mainly strophic. So for one air, you could sing three, four, five strophes. And what is interesting in this refinement, in this galanterie, is that occurs a new genre of a new style of music, which is based on ornamentation. So you will hear five times the same tune, but each time will be differently ornamented or improvised by the singer. And it's, I think at this moment, it's like an invention of an art of singing, very different from the Italian music, and based on, I say improvisations, but theorists of this time say on the bon goût. But bon goût means what today? Who has bon goût? So this good taste is, of course, very personal. But I think it's a music that let this space for the singers to improvise, to create on this route of the tune.
Interesting. This reminds me of something I meant to ask you earlier about the instrument, back to the instruments. We know something about this group, the 24 violins of the king. Is this the time in which that came to the fore?
The orchestra of the 24 violons was created a little bit before, and it was always used for mainly for the great shows. So for the... as you know, the violin was at this time not so noble instrument as today. It was played by the ménestriers, which were mainly traditional music players, and the best amongst these ménestriers were engaged in the 24 violons to play the royal orchestra. But this orchestra at the beginning was really involved in the great shows, or dance music, but not so much for refined music. Mm-hmm. For refined music, the tradition, the noble tradition, preferred the lute, the gamba, and maybe softer instruments. From Lully, I think it's a big change, and Lully as a violinist changed the way of playing also, and from this moment, the 24 violon became higher and higher, and finally played in the great shows too.
Interesting, and the distinction you made between the violinists and the masters, the maestros of the court. It's interesting too that they were at a super high level. The people like Gaudron and Boisset were like courtiers themselves. They were very exalted, relatively speaking, to the regular musicians. But what an amazing operation, you know, which we cannot, no modern court, no presidents today have such incredible music at their command. Well, what in terms of the overall performance of your Pleasures of the Louvre, I just wanted to ask you for a moment to talk about the experience of recording at the Louvre. Obviously, you weren't in the palace, but I believe you have recorded for us an introduction in an historic part of the palace.
Yeah, we had the chance, the incredible chance of having the museum just for us. And I've never seen that in my life. The Louvre absolutely empty. So we also had the choice of a painting hall, and I've chosen to be around beautiful painters like Philippe de Champaigne, which is one of my preferred, and the Poussin. We had also the great painters of this century, and I think it was just a clin d'œil. To show just what the people of this time who could hear this music could also see in the same place. So these beautiful paintings were imagined, created at the real same time the music we have played. So it was something we wanted to share with you.
Wonderful. Well, we are so pleased and so excited about it. So this project has been a project of the Library of Congress and the Musique du Louvre series. And we wanted to thank Laurent Muraro for this, his generous help in this. It would not be happening without him. And also to thank Denise Canel and Maya Gavili from the French Embassy here in the United States. And we hope, oh, one final question. You're going to be doing, I believe you're having plans now for the future, and we hope the future is coming soon. But you understand from your colleagues are going to be doing a traveling masterclass. You're planning to do a project where you travel as you did in France in the US. Is that coming together now?
Oh, I think they go faster than me. I told the team I have a dream. Yes, because I love to exchange. I love to share all the music we know. All the also the manner of playing, and I'm so always so happy to share it with students. And I as I had. A lecture with University of Yale a few days ago, I was telling my team, oh, I would like so much to organize a summer academy because, yeah, we have a lot of music to share with American students, and I think that could be really a great project. I would like to organize. I don't know, within 2-3 years, I don't know. We have to dream.
Exactly. Well, thank you for dreaming this beautiful music for us. We're very excited about the program. Good to talk with you, and we will continue. Perhaps you can do research at the Library of Congress on your next trip to the U.S.